individuals, and they asked them the question, how many decisions do you make about food a day? And the people estimated, they said, we make about 15 decisions. Then they had them actually go through a process, they asked them questions, and they actually recorded how many decisions they made. And they were about 200 decisions short. So they estimated 15 decisions, they actually made 215 decisions a day. And what that tells you is that the majority of decisions that we make in a given day are unconscious. Now I'd make the argument that some of the decisions we think about may not be the right ones we actually need to put our time and energy to. And the decisions that we make around food, those 200 decisions, the majority of them being unconscious, may actually be the decisions that determine how long we live. And they may determine the quality of that life that we have. So in some cases, those unconscious decisions that we are making, or that we are making for people, in the case of folks that are relying on us to provide food for them, are really life and death situations. So I would argue that those are the things that we actually need to put our thought into. Last year, a study came out, and this was a very large global burden of disease study, and really has shown things that we've already known for a long time, that poor diet is actually the leading cause of death in America. A very large study published in the Journal of the American Medical Association and looked at the global burden of disease, and this was in 2016, compared that to numbers in 1990, and looked at life expectancy, looking at disability and those types of things, and over 333 causes, and looked at 84 different risk factors. Out of all of those risk factors, diet actually came out to be the highest risk. So in 2016, over 500,000 people died, and it was a direct consequence and result of the diet that they had chosen to eat. Hard to see that because of the light, but dietary risk factor is up there at the top. And the colors represent what the diseases were that were associated with death. And so no surprise, those diseases are related to cardiovascular disease. That was the most common cause of diet-related death. We had diabetes there in the purple, and we also have cancer. Those three diseases are among the top 10 killers in our country right now. So we have to think about, and I'm a researcher as well as a pharmacist, and so my mind automatically goes to why is this happening? What is it in food that's actually causing have good things expressed, bad things expressed. So you can actually turn things on and modulate your own genome by what you take into your body, which to me is completely fascinating that you're able to do that. Now, I shouldn't be surprised if there's a very good example from nature. Since anybody, I don't have bees yet, but on my farm that I have, which is in downtown High Point, and on an acre of land that you may, it's really small, but it's my little farm that I have now. I want bees. So I'm learning about bees. And one of the fascinating things I learned about them is the way they use food to manipulate their social structure. Does anybody know what they do? Put it here. I'm going to give you the microphone, but you got it. So depending on the bees will determine who they want to be the queen. They decide, right? And then depending on who they decide to be the queen, they're going to feed that queen bee different things. And the nutritional content of the honey that the queen bee gets is very, very different from the content of the ones the worker bees are going to get. And what happens with that? The queen bee develops very differently. So she's not only bigger, but she's actually able to reproduce, whereas the worker bees are smaller and they're not able to reproduce. So simply, they're genetically the same. Same DNA code, same everything. But depending on what food bees are fed when they're larvae, it's going to determine the way they develop. It's a perfect example of how you turn certain genes on and off. And believe it or not, we can do the same thing in ourselves with the type of food that we take. All right. So I've put enough science in here so you believe me. But I don't want so much that I'm going to bore you. But this actually just shows an example of what I'm talking about here, where you have two very different nutrient and dietary signals. On the first, on the right-hand side, or your left-hand side, whichever side, showing a normal mechanism where you have a dietary signal coming in. There's mechanisms that happen. You have certain genes, and whatever is normal, the normal expression is going to happen. And you have sort of a homeostasis, a normal situation. The other situation is where you have nutrients and different dietary signals, and then something happens. And so this will a different communication happens. A different signal that comes through actually causes your genes to produce different proteins. There's different expression there. So instead of being a normal sort of homeostatic condition, you actually have a disease condition. And again, everybody starts out, that individual has the same DNA structure, but depending on what nutrients you're exposed to, and what type of communication you had, you're going to have a very, very different outcome. And these are just some examples of how the nutrients we take in, so the common macronutrients, the fat, carbs, and proteins, and the micronutrients, what some of those compounds are that actually have some transcription factors. And all the transcription factor means that these up or down regulate gene expression. So by taking in amino acids and the proteins, then you're going to up or down regulate these transcription factors that's going to cause different proteins to be expressed. And the point was not to memorize what that was. My students would say, well, then you know a test, right? That's not a test, but I wanted to give you some examples of how things that we take in every day really do have some modulatory effects on our DNA. for babies you hold in the palm of your hand, these babies would die if we didn't treat them with anti-infectives and medications they needed. So please don't think that I'm saying don't take medication. But there are times when medications are not the right tool for the job. Just like in this gentleman's situation, he's not going to get very far. Despite the fact we use a lot of medications here in this country. So the top bar looks at the total number of prescriptions here in the U.S. And that blue bar in the very front, 45%, so almost 50% of people in the United States take at least one prescription medication. And that number goes up to 85% if you look at people that are 60 years of age and older. When you look at what the medications are that people are taking down here in the bottom, the most common things people are taking are medications for these things, these diseases we just talked about. So lipid-lowering drugs, anti-diabetic, things for heart disease. So we use a lot of medications, and the most common medications we use in these populations are related to the most common diseases for the cause of death that we see. I make the argument that the medications are effective, so they do their job, but are we using the medications to treat the symptoms? We just have the tip of the iceberg. And if we actually use medications in conjunction with nutritional intervention, or even just use a nutritional intervention alone, are we going to be more effective because we're not only testing the symptoms, but we're actually treating everything there that's in the surface? So can we actually treat chronic disease, like heart disease and diabetes, with nutritional intervention? And the answer is absolutely. Dean Ornish, you may have heard his name, he's a cardiologist, been around for a long time. 20 years ago, did a study about intensive lifestyle changes for not only treating it, but people he reversed coronary artery disease. So I want you to think about that. You have arteries that are clogged, and by using nutritional information, he not only stopped it, but he reversed it. Okay? Medications don't even reverse that. The only way that we do that is have a procedure where you go in and root the arteries out. Okay? But when you look at what actually happened, this is showing the change in stenosis, just the amount of blockage you had in this artery over a five-year period. So you can see the people, the black dots are going up. So that's the percentage change in stenosis that went from 40 to 51% blockage in that artery. Whereas the people that actually were treated with nutritional intervention only went down. The people that were most compliant with nutritional intervention, so when you look at the most adherence, could drop the stenosis in the artery by 7%. I'm not talking just treating this and controlling it and stopping progression. This is reversal. It's something that drugs are not able to do. These people are not anything but intensive lifestyle management. And really what that management was a plant-based diet. Okay? So high in fruits and vegetables, high in whole grains, and plant-based protein. Another study that's pretty substantial that shows not only life stopping progression of artery disease, but also the reversal of disease. These are pictures here that are showing the impact this can actually have. Okay? So we look at, this is a PET scan, basically, and this is showing blood flow to the heart. And we look here at the top, before they were treated, and then we look here afterwards, and you can very clearly see that there's a restoration of blood flow. Okay? If you don't have blood flow to your heart, the muscle dies. That's called a heart attack, right? So people were able to completely restore blood flow to the heart and people with plant-based diets. And you see down here in the bottom how long it was? It was 3 weeks. You can do anything for 3 weeks, right? But 3 weeks of a plant-based diet not only stopped it, but it restored blood flow to the myocardium, or blood flow to the heart. Here we have a picture of a coronary artery, and this is 32 months after a plant-based nutritional intervention, again, without cholesterol-lowering medications. So no drugs, just the dietary intervention. You can clearly see that there is a restoration of blood flow. Okay? So pretty amazing results that we see in things that we can't even see with medications with a plant-based diet. So then do we actually move from, are we moving from the pharmacy to the pharmacy? And is that a better choice for our patients? There's a lot of stuff out there. So if you look, physicians in grocery stores, and they're walking around consulting with patients when they're walking around. And there's a lot of information about that these programs are actually very, very effective. They not only improve outcomes in our patients, but this is a study that was actually done to simulate what the impact, financial impact would be if Medicare and Medicaid actually subsidized this, that actually paid for the prescription for produce program. And the result would be prevention of about 2 million, heart disease in about 2 million people. If you prevent heart disease in about 2 million people, do you realize how much money you're actually going to save? It's huge. And one of the most exciting things about my job here, aside from building a program, is that I've been able to build these collaborations with all of these wonderful people here. So in the School of Pharmacy, we have a great collaboration with Carl and his group, and they're always putting us, involving us in things to try to relate food and medicine and how our students in pharmacy can come and help. We have a great collaboration with the Highland Public Library and the Farmers Market, and S.E. Lee, and the folks in the library back there. And we have folks, health science and pharmacy people, out at the Farmers Market every week doing health screenings and talking to people about food and their health. And then the Triad Food Pantry, we also have a fantastic relationship there where we decided to take our pharmacists on the road. And so when the food pantry meets, we are there at the food pantry every month, and we have an established group of patients that come in there and we're following them. So we figured if they couldn't get to us, we